we're going to talk about kind of the stuff of life today.
The Finding Your Roots curriculum has been developed and tested through a number of pilot camps, and staffers have already seen kids' research into family history reveal painful stories related to skin color and the concept of race.
We had a young man who was like, the only reason I'm European is because a white man raped one of my ancestors. And that's a heavy conversation to have with a kid. But until we have them, it's not like they go away. It's not like the pain of that goes away if we don't talk about it. Many teachers might not want to have those conversations. And the next step of the development of this curriculum is figuring out what kinds of support do teachers and students feel that they need in order to engage with this curriculum to the full extent possible. Because we didn't really expect kids to have these kinds of conversations that were open and fruitful and thoughtful. But there they were, having them. And we had adults in the room who were willing to go there and willing to listen and willing to let kids lead the talk.
Despite these challenges, researchers are confident that genetics and genealogy work together to illuminate and open the conversation.
One of the strongest aspects of this curriculum is that it naturally brings together genetics, that is biology, with history, where the genealogies of people are connected. It also brings together sociology. How do we think about human diversity? And when I understand something about my genealogy and my ancestry and my evolution, and I understand about how people created race concepts on the basis of no facts whatsoever, and I understand how people started treating races differently on the basis of blind ignorance, yeah, it all makes sense.
The Finding Your Roots campers have seen their individual DNA test results and the likelihood that each would exhibit certain observable genetic traits. They have learned the importance of evolution and natural selection through change over time. Now, Professor O wants them to examine a genetic trait that stares them right in the face.
But we mentioned one. You mentioned one that's extremely important. What did you say?
Skin color.
There you go. Beautiful. Kind of obvious. Kind of stand, right? Stands out. And we can begin to think about these things. My best friend's son, when he was a little boy, he's three. He's blonde, you know, hair lighter than yours. And I was babysitting him one day. And he asked me one day this famous question. He said, why are you brown? Right? And he was asking he was three, so he doesn't understand. He basically just put his hand next to mine, and he's like, and he loves me, that's my boy. I mean, we were very, very close. But he was asking a basic question. He was like, why are you brown? And I was like, oh my, what am I gonna say? I know the adults, you know, the adults will go, oh gosh, that's complicated, how am I gonna have this conversation? And I got away with it by saying, because my mommy and daddy were brown. And he was like, oh, okay. And he was satisfied. But here, we're gonna have a very special guest here today who's really going to explain, all right? So I'm gonna welcome Tina Lasisi. She is a PhD candidate in anthropology.
Hey guys.
And she's gonna be hanging out with us for a few days, but first she's gonna talk about that question, okay?
Yes. My name is Tina Lasisi, and I'm a third-year PhD student. I came to the Finding Your Roots Genetics and Genealogy summer camp to teach about the evolution of skin color.
You guys know about evolution, things change over time, and one of the mechanisms of evolution, natural selection. Now, this means that we get to delve into skin color now.
I was really excited to talk about it because it's something that these kids and everyone will have thought about at some point or another in their life, and to get the opportunity to talk about it in a scientific way, as opposed to talking about the social perspectives of it, is pretty exciting.
Now, skin color is something that's pretty obvious. It's something that you see. And like for me personally, it's something that I've noticed. So my dad is from Nigeria. And my mom is from Bulgaria. So my mom has really light skin. My dad has really dark skin. And I'm kind of in the middle. And I never really wondered why. I just accepted that fact. I was like, okay, my dad, he's from Africa. A lot of people from Africa have dark skin. A lot of people from Europe, like my mom, have light skin. That's the way it is. And for the longest time, this really kind of like obvious human physical trait, people were thinking about it that way. They were explaining it in that way. They were saying, well, you just have people who have light skin, you have people who have dark skin. But then Darwin wrote on the origin of species, and the idea of natural selection came up. So people started thinking about skin color again. And they started thinking about skin color and natural selection.
Skin color is a very variable trait amongst humans, and it's something that has changed and evolved multiple times over during the course of human evolution in different populations. So for some of these groups in the last 2,000, 3,000, 5,000 years, this is something that could have changed dramatically from dark skin to light skin and vice versa.
This is a completely plastic trait. It changes really, really rapidly in human evolution. I mean, that's really cool, but it means that skin color has no inherent value in classifying people because you get the same color evolving independently in many lineages of people.
And you have the other map.
Tina brought up a map plotting average skin color distribution around the world and a map of average intensity of ultraviolet radiation. They show a direct correlation. But what is it about UV radiation that drives natural selection for skin pigmentation in humans?
So do you know why dark skin actually protects you from the sun? What is it about dark skin that makes it dark? Yeah?
We have something inside of our skin that makes our skin darker. I think it starts with the M.
Melanin.
Yeah.
Exactly, there you go, perfect.
The pigment called melanin is produced in the outer layer of the skin in a type of cell called a melanocyte. And inside the melanocytes are tiny spheres called melanosomes that create melanin. Skin color is determined by the type of melanin, the amount of melanin, and the number of melanosomes, which all varies from person to person. In skin cells, melanosomes form a cap shielding the nucleus, absorbing UV radiation from the sun, and protecting against skin cancer and other harmful effects.
And one particular thing turns out to be really important in the evolution of skin color, and that's folate. So UV radiation can destroy folate. It's a type of B vitamin. So like if you look at women's pregnant sections in the supermarket, you sometimes have like, you know, these multivitamins, and specifically folic acid. If you make sure you get enough folic acid, then you can make sure that you have a healthy baby.
So the more melanin you have that protects the folate from the UV rays is going to increase your likelihood to survive to reproduce children who are happy and healthy and cancer-free.
So that way we can understand why darker skin evolved in these high UV radiation places. So when you're thinking about places with low UV radiation, you have the opposite problem. Your folate isn't so much in danger because the UV radiation can't damage it, it's too weak. But you need to produce a maximum amount of vitamin D.
Vitamin D is something that you make because of the sun. It helps your bones grow strong. And if you don't have enough vitamin D, you don't have as many healthy babies. So what you get then is natural selection working in the opposite direction. And so you get an evolution of people who are lightly pigmented. Yep.
Can having like too much melanin or too little cause like diseases or anything?
You can have too much melanin for a certain region in order to be healthy. The cool thing about humans is that we have culture. So once we started finding out these things, we were able to help a lot of people. So for example, me and my dad, because we have kind of darker skin, we started taking vitamin D supplements. We feel a little bit better now. And people who have light skin, have you ever been out in the sun and gotten a sunburn? Hey, right? Sunscreen. Sunscreen helps us. And that's why you end up having this really cool balancing act between protecting your folate to make healthy babies, but also getting enough vitamin D to make healthy babies. Yes, natural selection and evolution are all about getting the most babies. And this cool balancing act explains why we have all of this diversity in this really, really obvious human trait. We all come from different places, and the reason we look the way we look is because of this long natural history called evolution.
So I think that it's really important never to underestimate kids. If you put evidence before them, they can make up their own minds. So this is an excellent opportunity to talk about the science behind this, how this is just a superficial trait, which isn't biologically related to anything else that we use to group people. And it's exciting for them.
Like my friend, she has an ombre, it's so weird.
Kids love to study themselves. We can show you how you can bring the tools of finding your roots into your after-school program, summer camp, or classroom. Check out what happens when kids study their own DNA and family history by viewing our education programs and trying our research-based curriculum materials. For more information, visit us online.
Major support for Finding Your Roots, The Seedlings, has been provided by the Benkovic Family Foundation, with additional support from WETA, Public Television for Greater Washington, the Hutchins Center for African and African American Research at Harvard, and the following. ¶¶